And so when I reached out to Cabo, he said, yeah. He said, yeah, I would like to do it on the 21st. He said, that's the day Malcolm was assassinated. It's the anniversary of Malcolm X assassination. And so I'm going to stop gabbing. Give thanks and praise to the Most High for our brother Kaba coming to join us on Black Knowledge Matters. And Brother Kaba, take it away.
Oh, my brother Imhotep Akibulan, I want to first thank you for inviting me to be a part of this conversation this evening. And to all those who have come on board to listen to this program, I just finished the Instagram Live talking about our great brother, El-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz. And I just recently saw the movie One Love with Bob Marley. And one of my favorites, my favorite song, in fact, it became a lullaby for my children. I used to sing this song every night when I would just be in the room with them. I'd come home from work. Sometimes I'd be getting home just as they were ready to go to bed. This is when we had two daughters. Our son had not yet been born. But I did it with him also. And I sang the last song on his last album, which I always believed that great prophets, the last thing they tell you is what they were born to tell you.
Redemption song.
Redemption song. Old pirates, yes, they rabbi.
Those eyes to
Die from
mercy.
merchant ships.
Yes.
There's a part of the song where Bob Marley says, "How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look?
Yes,
Some
yes.
say it's just a part of it. We have to fulfill the book."
Yes, I.
And I think that having seen Bob Marley's movie and here now, see, for me, death doesn't exist the way it is in today's world. Death is a doorway in the eternal temple of immortality. Western civilization has a very grim look upon death. It is, in certain ways, a finality. But it is believed within the African framework of thought, and we could go to West Africa, East Africa, Central Africa, North Africa, Southern Africa. And there is just a belief that as a spiritual system, as an energy system, each and every one of us, when we were born, our spirit died and was encased in a tomb that we call a body. And that we lived a life system in order to be able to prove, like what Muhammad Ali used to say, that everything he did in his life was to pay rent for his room in heaven. And that everything that you do in life is what allows you now to return back to Amenta, to the concept of heaven. Hopefully, purer and more conscious than you were when you first came in at conception and birth. And that you were given an assignment before you were born. And, you know, like what I tell folk all the time is I say, just think about all of the people that had to come into existence to bring you into existence. When you think about the ancestors, when you think about who each and every one of us carry within us, I'm gonna do the math of it. I call it E to the three. It's called the exponential expansion equation, E to the three. You have two parents, four grandparents, eight great grandparents. And you can go down, if I took you back 20 generations, and let's say that a generation is 25 years. If I took you back to the year 1524, and we asked ourselves, how many human beings came into existence to bring me into existence? By math, this ain't emotion, it's now math, E to the three. 1,048,576 human beings came into existence to bring you into existence if we go back 500 years. So when we think about who dwells within us, when we talk about our ancestors, if I took you back 500 years, within you, there's 1,048,576 576 human beings. But hey, let's drop the other shoe. I only brought you back 500 years. How many do you think you have if I took you back 5 million years?
All right.
Just think of that number of how many people dwell within you. How many stories of happiness and sadness, success and not so success? How many stories exist within us every day that brought us into existence? Now, that's half the story. How many people came into existence to bring you into existence? But now the other side of it is, how many people did not come into existence in order to bring you into existence? Of all of the billions of sperm cells that your daddy had, and all of the billions of eggs that your mother had, why was it that unique spermatozoon and that specific egg that came together that created you? Because if any other sperm or egg had been fertilized, it wouldn't be you. It would be of you, but it wouldn't be you. So not only do we have people who came into existence to bring us into existence, we have billions of people who did not come into existence in order to bring us into existence, because we all have a divine purpose on this planet. We had the divine assignment before we were even conceived. And when we were ready to do what we were born to do, that's when we were conceived. And that's how our ancestors thought. We have things that we have to do. And Malcolm X lived 39 years, was assassinated 59 years ago. He came. He did his job, and then he returned back to the ancestors. Now, Betty Shabazz is with him. His grandson, Malcolm, is with him. Martin Luther King and him are together. Fannie Lou Hamer and him are together. And one day, I hope, in the far future, we'll all be there together, back into the waters of Nun.
Talk about that, Kaba. What are those, the waters of Nun?
Well, according to our ancestors, you held up the book Shabaka Stone. Shabaka Stone is a rewritten version of a much older document known as the Memphite Theology. And I was first introduced to the Memphite Theology through a Xerox copy that my mother gave me. Because my mother worked for an oil company. She was a secretary. And in these big corporations, you know, you have what's known as Xerox rooms.
Yes.
Where you just bring your work down to be Xeroxed by a team, and you go back down when it's ready and you bring it up, contracts, things like that. But you see, on the underground, a lot of these brothers and sisters that worked at a Xerox, they used to make Xerox copies of some of the books that we couldn't get a hold of.
Right. All right.
Gerald Massey,
yes.
All of the different works. But in this particular case, they made a copy of Stolen Legacy by George G.M. James. Chapter 8, page 139 to 151. Mother brought this book home. Well, it was a Xerox copy. She said some of the folk in the Xerox department said, because I had been writing about Ethiopia and she was making copies for me. So a lot of the brothers and sisters probably that were making Xerox copies of my mother's work on the sly probably saw it. And she said that they said to my mother, your son wrote this? And she said, yeah. You know, that's my son's work. And they said, well, if your son wrote this, I know he liked this. That's where I got the Xerox copy of Stolen Legacy.
Now, what year was that?
This would be 1976.
Wow. You know what? That's the year that Asa Hilliard released it.
That's right. It was just before he had released it.
Wow.
It was just before he released it. And when I read that, because I was into astronomy. I wanted to be an astronaut growing up. Things didn't happen the way I had planned, but I always had a interest in astronomy, in the heavens, always looking out to see what was going on. And that chapter, the Memphite theology that is rewritten on Shabaka's stone. I promised myself one day I was going to write a book. I had to write a book to talk about what I had experienced. And through the years, I've met Dr. Theofali Obenga, who helped me sort of kind of figure out the nun, you know, exactly what it is. And Sheikh Anta Diop, who was a fellow educator with Theofali Obenga, and Dr. Obenga even credits Dr. Sheikh Anta Diop in being like his older brother, his older teacher. In his book, Civilization or Barbarism, chapter 17, it deals with doesn't African philosophy exist? Now, this is where Dr. Diop goes deep inside the nun.
Yes, keep going. Yes.
Okay. Deep inside the nun. There's a book, Egypt Revisited, where Jacques Abibsi writes an article, essay, about Dr. Theofali Obenga's work. And then the following essay is Dr. Theofali Obenga talking about the Memphite theology or the Shabaka stone. I've worked with Dr. Jacob Carruthers, the brilliant scholar out of Chicago, in his great work on Shabaka stone. And this story has to be seen for what it really is, because it answers all the questions in life. And see, back in 1976, I had never been exposed to this type of deep philosophy before from someone like Dr. George G.M. James. Just the whole book is great, but this particular chapter and these pages, 139 to 151, It just, if someone said to me, you know, could you name some of the turning points in your life?
Wow.
That book would have been one of them. It was just a turning point in terms of my thinking and understanding. It goes back to Bob Marley in Redemption Song when he says, have no fear for atomic energy, which is Western civilization. Have no fear for atomic energy, because none of them can stop the time.
Yes.
See, this was the messages. And at this time, this is when I was first exposed. I was first exposed to Bob Marley in 1975 with his album Naughty Dread.
Yes.
And so there's so many things that are going on. I'm in college, going to New York University. And there are so many things going on at this time that it's just a powerful time to be alive. And as I began to read this book, I promised myself I was going to write a book. However, I also said, but I got to drop something on the community so that they could possibly understand what I mean when I talk about Shabaka Stone. And so I wrote Spirituality Before Religions. Because Spirituality Before Religions is where I examine the text, the pyramid text, the coffin text, the book of the coming forth today by night, the Aten text. And I try to put it in a common sense approach. Spirituality Before Religion, subtitled Spirituality is Unseen Science, Science is Seen Spirituality. I think this is one of the cornerstones to what they got us tripped over. I believe that spirituality and science is two sides of the same coin. If I showed you a coin that had a head on it, would I have to tell you that the other side was the tail? If I were to show you a sheet of leather, would I have to tell you that suede is on the other side? Well, that's the way spirituality and science is. Spirituality is unseen science. But if you're able to decipher science, science coming from the word scient, which means knowledge, it's not just what we perceive it to be, oceanography and psychology and biology and chemistry. Science comes from an African word, but the Greeks got it, scient. This is why we say that God is omniscient, all-knowing, because scient means knowing. It means knowledge. And so when you look at spirituality before religion. What I'm trying to get to is, I don't have a religion for our people. We are, in many ways, a religionless people. We are spiritually bound. We are bound by spirit. And spirit is what emanates. But when you want to start a gang, they took spirituality. I'm speaking of those who wish to oppress us. They took spirituality and created little gangs. And these became religions, where they learned to dominate the followers. This is how you pray. This is how you worship. This is who you're worshiping. This is how you are to worship them. And don't forget to put some money in the basket. And so I don't have a religion for our people. But what I want to tell our people, if you Christian, Africanize it. If you Hebrew, Africanize it. If you Muslim, Africanize it. If you're Buddhist, Africanize it. Because deep inside that spiritual system is the Osirian drama.
All right.
And the waters of the gun.
What is that? What is that? Osirian drama.
The Osirian drama.
Is that Muslim?
That is all Kemetic. This Kush Kemet.
All right.
And the bottom line is that the Osirian drama, basically, you can go to the characters. I understand that. Osir is the father. Aset is the mother. Heru is the child. Nebetet is the oracle reader. Seton is the opposite of Osir. Because the other thing is that the way in which my interpretation of African philosophy is, there's no such thing as bad. There's good and what exists when it ain't good. But they also realize there are times that what you consider to be not good is necessary to get back to the good. So you have the path of Ma'at, the righteous path.
And being balanced.
Balance, harmony, justice, truth, order, arrangement, reciprocity. And then when you're not on the path of Ma'at, Dr. Asa Hilliard, Nanabafor Amantwakia, tells us that you're on the path of Ishvet. But at the same time, what I've come to realize in my life, and I'm sure that some of us have experienced this also, some of the greatest lessons I ever learned, I learned on Ishvet. Because it's when you're not on the right path that you understand what the right path is. Some people spend their life on the wrong path, but that's a whole nother story. But for those people that become aware of the fact, I'm not on the right path, this ain't the right thing, you then understand and respect more the right path. And so in the African philosophy, I've come to realize that the concepts of evil and bad are a Western mindset, something that Dr. Jacob Carruthers talks to us about. So that everything has its place. You know, it's like when, if God was the one that created everything, well, God also created the devil. And so it becomes like an existential conversation. Because if God was all good, how could he create something that was bad? But that was never the African philosophy. That's what the Western mindset did. Make things bad. First of all, Lucifer comes from the word light. And when you talk about Lucifer was the fallen angel that came down to earth, what you're really talking about is light, heat, and sound energy that are rays of energy that come from the sun. Luce, light. So they got Lucifer being bad, but Lucifer was not bad. Lucifer had nothing to do with the devil. But we're caught up in the story itself. But spirituality before religions was written to understand Shabaka Stone, because Shabaka, okay, here's another thing about how sort of kind of convoluted things are. I grew up Roman Catholic. I came to realize that there was an Old Testament and there was a New Testament. And the Old Testament started with the five books of Moses. And the Old Testament created what we call Judaism. Couldn't have been called Judaism because the letter J didn't exist in the alphabet until 1526. His name couldn't have been Jesus. The betrayer could not have been Judas, and he could not have been called a Jew because the letter J did not exist. In Kemet, it's a DJ sound, J. Because to make the J sound, you got to have a D that precedes it. Okay, but the sound J, like the Jed column, is DJED. The Jedi Knight is DJEDI. And so, okay, so Moses, which means son of, was the one that created a long line out of the house of David, Solomon, and all down the line. And what they don't tell you about the story of Moses is that his followers murdered him.
Ooh.
But in their shame, they promised that a Messiah, that was going to be a second coming of the Messiah, who was Moses. Now, Mez means son of in the African language. Thutmosis, Ra Moses. Moses means son of. Ra Moses, son of the sun. Thutmosis is son of Thoth. Akhmosis is son of Akh. So the word Moses itself is just part of what means the son of. And that's where the word Messiah comes from. And so they promised that there would be a Messiah that would come to take away the sins of the world. And so what they did is that in this story, they then have this next time, which really is astronomical constellation known as Pisces or the fish, where they then created a story that 2,024 years ago, there was a child born. And this child's name was Jesus. And that they saw him as the second coming, and that this Jesus was going to take away the sins of the world. Herod found out about him, was chasing him down when he was a baby. Pontius Pilate didn't want nothing to do with him, because his wife told him, you know, honey, I had a bad dream last night. Leave that Jesus alone. But the reality of it is that Christianity is based on the Amen priesthood. And the Pope is the Pharaoh, or the Neset Biti. The Amen priesthood. That is why you have the cardinals, the high priests, and the bishops. They left the women out altogether. In Africa, you had priestesses. Okay, well, no priest without a priestess. So the Africans didn't have a concept of a male-only dominated spiritual system.
Hold your point right there, Kaba. My wife was telling me she was watching some Baptist convention, and they had a woman speaker. This is a Black Baptist convention, and they had a woman speaker. And they erased her her speech because you're not supposed to have a woman preaching in the church. Mm. That's how far we've gotten.
Yeah, that's it.
That's how far, yeah.
And it's a slave mentality.
We're out of balance. We're out of balance.
Absolutely. Yes. We're on the path of Ishvet, you know, which is disorder, disarrangement. It is not the truth. It is not balance. It's imbalance. And this is why the world is where it is, because as a brother, I understand something very clearly. And that without the dynamic interaction of a sister, you only got half the story.
All right. All right. Say that again.
Without the proper place that women have in society, you only got half the story. You know, the great psychiatrist, the clinical psychiatrist, Dr. Edwin Nichols, he told us a story one time that he worked in different corporations, you know, on psychological levels. And he said that he gave everybody a questionnaire. Now, what I want to do is I want to paraphrase this because I don't have the exact story, but this is the story that he told. And I'm going to say, like, he gave everybody, the males and the females a test in this corporation. Same test. And I'm going to say 10 questions just to make it simple to understand for me to be able to explain it. And he said that when the test was reviewed, there were questions that all the men got right and all the women got wrong. There were some questions that the men got right and the women got right. And there were some questions that the women got right and the men got wrong. And so what becomes the end result of what he was telling us is the only way you can have balance in a society is to have a balance between the male and female energy. And when we come out of the African tradition, the true African tradition, you can see that our ancestors understood that for every god, you have to have a goddess. For every priest, you have to have a priestess. It's not one better than the other. It's not one over. It's not one in front, one in back. We're beside each other, walking forward and creating a civilization. That's what built the pyramids. That's what built the temples. That's what created a continuity amongst the Twa and Mbuti people of Central and Southern Africa that would create the society that we're living in today. Dr. Oba Tshaka, I mean, that brother drops to about the Twa and Mbuti Khoisan people.
Yes. Yeah.
Much respect to the work that Oba Tshaka has done on the Twa people. Rosalind Jeffries has gone to visit them. My brother Omega Oxel, who we're doing a, I'm co-hosting a tour to Kemet this summer, June 16th to June 26th. This is the work that he has done. He has gone with his brother Shaka Bars to Congo to build communities and to get water for the community, to understand who these short statured people are. Maybe 3'8", they're giants of 5'1". Perfectly symmetrical people. They are the fathers and the mothers of the human family. They are derogatorily called pygmies. So that as we move through this process and we understand what we're looking at, the Shabaka stone actually got it twisted. Because the Amen, because Moses, there's a book called Moses and Akhenaten, where they are saying, see, what they do is that they take our historical figures through a spiritual lens and they superimpose mythological figures and create religions. So Moses historically actually is Pharaoh Neset-Bti Akhenaten of the 18th dynasty. His parents, Amenhotep III, and Queen Tai actually is Solomon and Sheba, historically. And King Tut, who many believe is his son, is Jesus Christ. And they built their entire story of religion around African historical figures. But the thing is that Moses and Akhenaten came in the 18th dynasty. The Amen priesthood was brought into Kush Kemet thousands of years before that. So what they did is they took the Old Testament and made it new, and they took the New Testament and they made it old. And so there's no way you could ever have balance in understanding the Bible, because they start with what happened thousands of years after what actually grounded. Because remember, Akhenaten was born Amenhotep IV. He was part of the Amen priesthood.
Professor Kaba, we have a question here.
Sure.
This may take you off on a tangent, but it's a question that nevertheless, because people want to know.
Sure.
Is there any connection between the Emerald Tablets of Thoth and religion?
Oh, well, you see, I want to be careful with the term religion.
Because
religion is something very different from what the Emerald Tablets of Tehuti, where we get the word thought from, The Emerald Tablets are related to the Kybalion. And there's another book that is a follow-up to the Kybalion that is called the Pyramidion. The Pymander, P-Y-M-A-N-D-E-R. Yeah.
The Pymander. Yes.
Now, what's important to understand about the Pymander is that the one that brought that book into existence was a black man who is the actual father of metaphysics in the Western world, whose name is Pascal Beverly Randolph. Google his name. Because he was the one that impacted all of the metaphysicians. He came from New York. He was a brother from New York. And what he did is he studied metaphysics. And he traveled throughout Europe. And he taught Europeans about metaphysics. He was very popular in Europe. He is the grounding of the Rosicrucians.
Hmm.
And he is the one that introduced Pymander to the Western world in the early 1900s. This was a black man. Even metaphysics was ours in the Western world. And I ask you, family, don't have to believe me. Because I don't want you to believe me. I want you to think.
Yes.
We're living in illusion. And so the Emerald Tablets comes from the concept of green, which is the color of Asar through resurrection.
Mm.
And so the overall story, see, emerald, brothers and sisters back in the day weren't going around calling things emerald. Somebody else called them emerald. And so when you look at the Emerald Tablets, there's a direct relationship between the spiritual systems, because Tehuti was the husband of Ma'at. Ma'at was the path, life that you walk on, truth, justice, balance, harmony, order, arrangement, reciprocity. But in order to be on the path, you had to have knowledge, understanding, and wisdom, which was Tehuti. And that's why they were married. Of course, we're thinking of marriage in the sense of husband and wife. But what's more important is that they are the left and right hemisphere of the brain. They are the holistic understanding of, in order to be on the right path, you have to have the right knowledge. And in order to have the right knowledge, you got to be on the right path. Electrical currents create magnetic fields. Magnetic fields create electrical currents. Together, being married, we call it electromagnetism.
Mm.
Science is seen spirituality. They live for each other. They are bound to each other, but they're two separate things, but they're bound to each other like your left and right hemisphere of your brain. It's one brain, but it's two aspects of the same brain. This is what I'm trying to get to with spirituality and science, because we got to move away from this emotion. These people out here talking about Christian nationalism. That doesn't exist. If you study your own New Testament, Jesus didn't burn crosses on black people's lawns. How are you going to take the symbol of your religion and create hate and divisiveness and then call it Christianity? When I studied the life of Jesus, man, that brother lived a powerful life. This brother would go out into the desert and he would pray and he would fast. And he'd come back in, and one of his students would bring him a cool glass of water. Jesus would look off to the side and see a thirsty child. And he would say, "Give the child the water." Jesus was so poor, he walked the earth with one sandal sometime. He ain't had no jet plane. He didn't preach from an arena. He was up on the mountain talking to the people. You telling me that's religion? We're at war right now where there are over 30,000 people, half of them are children, have been murdered for no reason whatsoever. You're telling me that that's your religion? That's what your God told you to do? Come on. We have to start to think. And in order to do that, I had to write a book for the children. And so I wrote Shabaka Stone for Children, an African Star Story.
Wow.
Because I was so impacted by Shabaka Stone in 1976, I said, I have to get this story to children and to help them understand. So what I did is I got two graphic artists and my son to draw pictures, to create visuals of Shabaka Stone, of the frogs and the snakes that remained in the waters. You ask yourself, well, why frogs and snakes? What was the importance of frogs and snakes? Well, frogs represent metamorphosis, the process of becoming, kepra, the process of becoming. And snakes were female. Frogs were male. Snakes were female. And so what do snakes represent? Well, snakes molt. They shed their skin. And when snakes know that they're about to molt, a film comes across their eyes like they cannot see. And they slither into a place where they can just be at rest with themselves. And while they're in that place, the old skin becomes very crusty, hard. And underneath the old skin is born a new skin. And when it's time to come up out of this so-called death, they slither across a very rough area. And when they slither, it cuts open the belly of the old skin and they come forward with a new skin. And then they can see. So the idea of molting to our ancestors represented the idea of resurrection, coming forward to the new life, leaving the old life behind, which goes back to the Asarian drama, because all religions are based on one thing, the resurrection of the soul. That's the story. How you live your life in order to receive the good life after you've died. And that's resurrection. Every religion deals with the saving of the soul. And that is what resurrection is. And, you know, my brother Imhotep, I know that the individual that asked that question said, and then you said it would take me off on a tangent, but, you know, I see this as a meeting at the African Square.
This is.
And while I've come with a specific purpose, as you and I have spoken, I also would like to have dialogue with the community, those that are here. So if they have any questions, no matter what it may be, please let them feel free to just ask the question. We'll talk about it.
All right. And since you said that, let's do this in an orderly manner. We have 41 participants on tonight. And if you would put your question in the chat, or you can raise your hand, you know, electronically, or if I can see you, I have two screens. So, you know, there's some people I can see and some people I can't. But I'm enjoying this conversation. I have a question. This is related to your book here, the Shabaka Stone, and it deals with the cosmic DNA.
Mm.
Cosmic DNA, chapter 6, God's, the Creator's voice on Earth, dealing with that. If you just say a few words about, this is really where I want to go. Dark matter, Atum's cosmic womb.
Dark, well, the universe is made up of two concepts. Dark matter and dark energy. Dark matter is less. Dark energy is the most. It's almost like 76, 75% to 25% dark matter, 75% dark energy.
Let me stop you there. So when we look at the as the Rastas would say, the Inaverse. And we see that all what's holding all of these things, the cosmos, is this blackness, is this void. Is that the black energy or the black matter?
If you see it, it's dark matter. What's keeping dark matter in place is dark energy.
All right. All right.
Spirituality is unseen science. Science has seen spirituality. So from a scientific perspective, dark matter is science and dark energy is spirituality. And so when you look at these two different dynamics, this is what you have. And Dr. Richard King talks about this in his books, The African Origins of Biological Psychiatry.
Let's pour a libation for that brother, Dr. Richard King. Yes.
Absolutely. Phenomenal. Yes. I'm about to publish my next book on melanin. It's called Carbon Before Melanin. Because, you know, I told you, I think we spoke the other day when we were talking about Maya. And I said that Dr. Sabi used to always say, Booker T. That was my name before I became Kaba Hiawatha. He said, you're always talking about melanin. You should talk about carbon. Carbon came before melanin. So I named my book, honoring Dr. Sabi, Carbon Before Melanin.
Hold tight, brethren. I see somebody on, and I hope I'm not embarrassing them by saying, but I see my sister Roberta Murdoch on, and she was the very first person to join Wosay Community Church.
Mm.
Very first person. Glad to see you, Sister Roberta. I just want to recognize you. And I see Destiny too. Destiny put some things in the chat too. Thank you, Destiny Muhammad. Thank you. Thank you. All right, brethren. Continue, please.
The idea Dr. Richard King talks about. One of the products that comes out of this gaseous blackness is something known as nanodiamonds. And in the universe, see, to me, the universe is everything. The cosmos is what comes out of the universe. So there's a difference. You have the universe, which is everything, and inside the universe, there is the cosmos, which is the ordered and arranged aspect of this dark matter, of this dark energy. And when the dark energy pushes in on dark matter, it pushes in until it becomes like a black dot, like a small blackness. It implodes. And it is nanodiamonds that create the stars. Stars are crystallized blackness.
Mm.
Stars are crystallized blackness.
You like that one, Queen Sheila? Like you like that?
Wow. Yes.
Science, not personal. You come down to Earth, you have blackness that is being pushed down, pressured. The dinosaurs. The living systems. Everything is being pushed in the earth. We go into earth and pull it up as black oil. We then chemicalize it into a gasoline, and that's what drives our car. You also have the blackness that comes in and is pushed so hard on each other, it implodes, and that's what diamonds are. Diamonds are crystallized blackness, crystallized fossil fuels. Diamonds are living things. Just another aspect of it, like the soul. That's why black folk are diamonds in the rough.
Mm.
Science, not personal. That's why they don't invite me places, because I don't get emotional with people. You know, you just drop the science on people. You can't argue with that. We understand this. We see this. Carbon is the very cornerstone. It's the glue that organizes and arranges the cosmic universe. That is why anything that we call living has to be carbon-based.
Mm. Mm.
science.
And
I don't
then,
talk about superiority or inferiority.
And then
I talk
Richard,
about dominant and recessive.
And then Richard King also told us about the black dot.
Yes. The atom.
Yes.
That's exactly what he meant. As I began to read his work and I began to get into it, I wrote a curriculum for children back in 1987. And he was the one that, in fact, the letter is in my book. He was the one that wrote the letter that was describing and reviewing my lesson plan on teaching children.
Dr. Richard King?
Yes.
Wow.
I worked with him between 82 and 85. When he first came to First World Alliance in New York, this was a lecture series, First World Alliance. Praise to Sister Kepha and Brother Bill, ancestors now, but they started a series of Saturday lectures. In the beginning, it was just
okay.
Dr. Ben.
I found this on the web for S of Saturday lectures.
Uh-oh.
Check it out.
Okay, let's mute ourselves. Sorry about
no,
that.
No, I think that was me. I think I might have touched Siri.
Oh, okay.
You
mean Siri is listening in to us? Siri stopped that.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Siri said, oh, I just found out some things about it. She think I'm talking to her. But Richard King came to New York and did a series and he said to us, he said, because I had heard about melanin from Dr. Frances Cress Welsing in the 70s when she came to New York. But I never focused on it, really. It wasn't up front to me. But in 1981, Brother Bill, Sister Kepha invited Dr. Richard King to come to New York to speak on melanin. This is when he had the black dot 1 and 2 in Xerox form.
Was that from the Aquarian Gospel Center books, Dr. Lagans?
He gives a lot of credit to the Aquarian organization and Dr. Lagan. Yes, yes. This, though, was a lecture series in New York.
Brother Kaba, we have a question now. Nisi, Miss Mariana, go ahead.
Peace, Baba Kaba. How you feeling? Thank you for being here.
Oh, no doubt. My sister, I think we were in contact yesterday, weren't we?
Yeah. We got some more to chat about, but I wanted to kind of open up the conversation towards something that I'm deeply passionate about. My netter work here in this lifetime is really for the social emotional development of our community members. And what I find is when we're studying all this greatness, we tend to romanticize it. And specifically through the lens of Ma'at, I would like for you to express what guidance you would have when it comes from us romanticizing the theory of operating with truth, justice, and righteousness, but how to actually embody that in the way we work with each other. Because I notice there's a separation where we see this sacred, divine walk of life. We see it as something our ancestors, you know, did in the past or did at one point. But when it comes to our mental health, our emotional hygiene, and even conflict management as African communities, we really struggle. And so I was wondering if you could give any guidance or any books of wise counsel and instruction that could help us through that when we're, you know, moving into our Afrotech sacred future.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Great question, my sister, because that's the cornerstone, because we tend to romanticize, which means for me, it means that we only show a certain side of it.
Yeah.
But there's another reality.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a reality because if we romanticized everything, our ancestors would not have created an Ishvet, which is the wrong path to be on. They would not have created the sacred lake of fire, which was their interpretations of hell.
Yes.
And to have those four baboons on either corner of the lake of fire. And they would not have had a judgment scene that weighed your heart against the feather of Ma'at.
And that crocodile ready for that heart.
That's right. I mean, they had Ahmet right there.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, what's interesting about Ahmet is that Ahmet was a combination of a lion, a hippopotamus,
crocodile.
And a crocodile. Three of the most feared animals to our ancestors. So just imagine that if you didn't live the right life, if your heart was heavier than the feather and it went down, Amit was known, A-M-M-I-T. Amit was known to be the devourer of evil hearts.
Mm-hmm.
And if that exists, then there also had to have been people that didn't follow Ma'at.
That's right.
And the other thing, my sister, is the fact, quite frankly, that Kemet could never have been taken over. In fact, wherever I study our history, be it Kush Kemet back during the Sixth Dynasty, whether it be the Moors in 1492, whether it be the plantation, the civil rights movement, or hip hop, I've never seen those who wish to oppress us come in and take us over. I've always seen them take advantage that we fight amongst ourselves.
Yes.
And that's one of the first things that we have to get off. We have to put that in check.
Mm-hmm.
But we fight amongst ourselves because we fight within ourselves. Each of us is born with a Judas and a Messiah. And it's Judas' job within us to ensure that we never are able to achieve our divine purpose in life.
Yes.
And the Messiah is born to make sure that Judas fails. Oh. Judas will fall 9 times, but the Messiah will rise 10. And so I think that one of the first conversations I think that we should have with our people is to have them put themselves in check.
Yes.
To look within. But you got to know how great you are.
Yeah.
You have to know what you have done to get where you got. So when you know how many ancestors that you have, we said 1,048,576. If you go back 500 years, 1524, all of the billions of people that were not born to give you permission to be born. You have a purpose. The other side of it, my sister, is I'm looking for 3 out of 100.
Mm.
But in terms of a book, I think an interesting book and some guidance would be Dr. Joy Degree.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And just an analysis of that. I also think that Dr. Edwin Nichols, who happens to be her mentor, I believe, is another person to research.
Thank you. But when
I'm dealing with our people and I'm talking to them, I first show them how great they are. But then I show them what can happen when you lose that. And everything for me doesn't start with your situation with other people. It starts with what's going on within you.
Yes.
And what has happened to us as a people over these past 400 years has been devastating. But what I admire is that there are people like you that haven't fallen there, that know that there's something better out here and that we got to get ourselves together. So I've got good news and I got bad news. The good news is Dr. King was right. We are going to make it to the promised land. We're going to get there. That's what I keep trying to tell our children. Don't let this okie doke that we see out here with these people.
Babylon.
Yes. They try to trick you and say only 144,000.
Yes. That's it. See, because they'll try to distract you.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is that you have to keep on keeping on. Mm-hmm. Our ancestors is evidence for me what we can do. If they could do what they did with what they were going through and what they had, I got it made. I wake up and I apologize if I think in my dream I'm having a hard day.
Mm-hmm.
We are so fortunate, whether we realize it or not, we have a lot of work to do.
Yes.
Because just like that good news is we're going to get to the promised land, the bad news, a lot of us ain't going to make it.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're trying to light a fireplace, you have 12 logs. You can't light all 12 because then you'll set yourself on fire. So what I do is I light the log that's closest to me.
I see.
And the first one lights the second to the third to the fourth. Pretty soon you have a roaring fireplace, but you only lit one log.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not taking it upon myself to have to solve the problems that have been going on for the past 500 years. My job is not to make it possible. My job is to make it possible to make it possible.
I see.
And so in your work, at the same time, we have to not get overwhelmed
mm-hmm.
with what we see we got to do.
Right.
You do the best that you can. Anything past your best is stress.
Yes.
And stress will kill. It messes up your whole system. And I lead by example. Do it by example.
Yes.
Show folk what it's like to be a true African. You can enjoy life. You enjoy food. You enjoy dance. You enjoy good things. Black folk love good things.
I'm going to interrupt. I'm sorry. I got a couple of questions I want to focus on. Thank you, Nisi, for that question. Somebody wrote in the chat, thank you for asking that question. One of the questions, Brother Kaba, is that do you teach classes? Where can people find your instruction, either online courses or courses that you've done? Can you direct us there?
My website.
Okay.
My website, www.kabakamene.com, KABAKAMENE.com. That's where I have my free e-course on spirituality before religions and my study guide. And my Instagram page I use as like a community bulletin board where I post things up. Like today I have things up on, we did a documentary, Harun Nesset and I did a documentary on what would Malcolm X do today? You know, we did not go back to 1965 or 1950 or 1955. We wanted to take the spirit of Malcolm and what he represented to us. And what would he do in 2022, I think it was that we did this, or 2021. What would Malcolm do today? So I have that up on my Instagram page. I have things such as the trip we're going to Kemet in June 16th to June 26th, how you can register if you're interested. So my Instagram page is like my community bulletin board. And you can go to Kaba Kamene, KABAKAMENE. And you can join
Bill, can you put that in the chat? Minister Bill, can you put that in the chat? I'm not so fast as typing as you are.
I went there. It went straight to that address with Gumroad inserted, yes. Correct? Okay. Good.
Yes. Yes. Gumroad is my distributor.
Good. I'll drop that in the chat.
So yeah, yes. Put that in the chat. Thank you. Thank you, Minister Bill.
And then my Instagram page.
And
that's my community bulletin board. I let folk know where I'm going, things that I'm doing. I put up ideas that we may be experiencing. I do Instagram lives like I did just before I came on here. I did an Instagram live. And so that's how you can contact. I've got quibinars and I've got webinars. My background is in education. Dr. Wade Nobles, brilliant scholar.
Yes.
He tells us to understand the difference between content and intent. Content is what you teach. Intent is how you teach it.
Mm-hmm.
And so Harun Nesset and I, Harun is my techspert. He's the brother that handles all of the technical aspects of my existence. And so we did a series of, we have a series of quibinars. Quibinars are quick webinars where we talk about teaching methodologies. You see, it's not just about what you teach, it's how you teach it. There's a place in the quibinars where I do something on episodic and holistic history. Episodic history is when you look at something as a person, a place, or a thing in a selected time within a selected geographic location. Episodic. So we look at the Moors. Let's say we look at the Moors from 711 to 1492. When you look at things episodically and you don't see what brought that into existence, then you can stick other people in there to take credit.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Like, I'll give you an example. The University of Sankore, Timbuktu. They can get you to believe that that was built by Arab Muslims.
Okay.
Because they give you Timbuktu during the three great kingdoms of Ghana, Mali, and Songhai. But first of all, it wasn't called Ghana. Ghana was the name of the king. Just like in the Malinke Empire, the name of the king was Mansa. And just like in Songhai, the name of the king was Askia. Ghana was not named. It was called Ouagadougou. That was the name of this kingdom that had been developed 2,500 years before the Christian or the Common Era. Out of four settlements that existed. Dar Tichit, Dar Walaga. So there were four that came into existence because of the movement of Africans from North Africa down, because that is when 5000 BC was when the Sahara, which was a fertile place, became a desert. And so Africans moved south and west into what we today call southern Mauritania, and they moved north into what we call the countries like Tunis and Morocco and the countries of North Africa, long before Arabs ever touched foot in Africa. So they get you to believe that Timbuktu was a university thousands of years before Islam ever existed. That's not to say that Muslims did not come and inhabit the area and bring certain things to that area, but whatever they brought when they learned from Africans, because Islam was formed in the mountains of Ethiopia and then brought into Saudi Arabia by Black people, specifically Bilal.
All right. Hold tight now. We have a couple more questions. We only have about 15 minutes left. Someone put in the chat, Amun-Ra Hotep, can you touch on the stars, the universe, how creating life, do our children choose us? It looks like is the main question. Do our children choose us?
I think I'd like to expand that concept. Our children are the result of a divine providence that brings them to us. I hope I'm clear on what I'm saying. Our children are the result of that. In Shabaka Stone and in Spirituality Before Religions, I talk about the concept, the idea of the thought. Everything came out of a thought. And thought created desire. Desire motivated the heart. The heart spoke the word, and the word made flesh. And so the concept of all of this, okay, let me step back a minute and let me add this. Dr. Edward Bruce Bynum, brilliant scholar, he says that the universal cosmic being exists in six dimensions. We are living in the first three because that's all the Western world could understand. Length, width, and depth. This out here that you experience. But African people, many thousands of years ago, understood that when you collapse length, width, and breadth, the first three dimensions, you create a fourth dimension. And that fourth dimension is the space, time-space continuum. Time is history. Space is geography. When you step into the time-space continuum, I'm going to stick a pin, and then I'm going to talk about the concept of deja vu. People say, oh, I've done this before. I feel like I've been here before. I feel like I've experienced this before. And my response to them is, yeah, you have, because you wrote the book. It's like when you write a book and then you go back and read it, and then you remind yourself of an event in the book. But of course, you wrote the book. Each and every one of us is born with a divine purpose. And it is Judas's job to make it so that you never fulfill your destiny. That's your job. And I got to tell you something. I appreciate Judas. Because I'm going to tell you something. Christianity would not exist without Judas. If Judas hadn't betrayed Christ, Christ wouldn't have been crucified and Christianity wouldn't exist.
Mm.
So you see how the dynamics of the antagonist and the protagonist is there always with the two sides moving back and forth in life so that I don't curse the darkness because it's in the darkness that I can see the light.
All right.
As African people, when your philosophical grounding is in that, what happens to you is an experience that allows you to do what you got to do. You don't curse the wind that brings bad time to you. Dr. King told us, your character is built during times of conflict and controversy, not during times of comfort and convenience. So instead of cursing the winds that brought misfortune, bless them because they gave you another opportunity to perfect your character. You know, when I go back and read and look at an African perspective through African eyes, which goes back to the Quibinars and the Webinars, methodology as opposed to content, what to know, it helps me understand that our ancestors lived a phenomenal cosmic life. We are blessed, family, to be here. This is a blessing. And this is why Black folk have been able to withstand this ma'afa, this terroristic disaster, because we realize that even in this terroristic disaster, there is reasons to celebrate. Because if you're still here, it means that you see the light in the dark, which means that you have now perfected your character. So I have no regrets of my past. Whatever happened to me now, of course, there are certain things I wish could have been altered, but still. I have no regrets because everything that happened to me brought me to be able to sit and talk to you great people this evening. Had anything changed in any of my history, I wouldn't be here. All of it led me to be here today. And we're caught up in distractions of the Western world because the Western world is Judas. And where we're headed in the promised land is the Messiah. Judas falls 9 times, but the Messiah will rise 10. You keep on keeping on. That's what our ancestors told us. Knowing that one day we'll all be together. So all the people that we miss, our mothers, our fathers, our grandparents, all the people that we may never know in our ancestry, if you go back to 1524, who have been a part of our ascendancy to where we are today, we're all going to be together one day. As much as I may miss my mother and my father and my sister, which I do, I know one day, hopefully not too soon, give me some time now, because I'm liking this, you know? But the idea is one day when that time comes that the ancestors and the creator call me home, we're all going to be together again, but this time for eternity.
Thanks. All right, let me ask them. So we have... We have about 8 minutes, and each of these questions that are here, are, you know, we can go into extra innings. But a brother asks, Dr. Kamene, your thoughts on financing ourselves.
That's it. That's why I've got all my DVDs streaming. That's why I write all my books. Because people say that money is the root of all evil, but money is also the root of our emancipation and liberation. It's not money that's bad, it's what you do with it. Right now, economics is not money. Eco comes from a Greek word, oikos, which means environment or home. Nomics is to know, like ecology is to know and study your environment. Economics is to know your environment. So money is only a means that they've created to keep us enslaved. But the bottom line to me really is the fact that we must do this ourselves. This is why I do everything that I do. I do it because I don't ask nobody else permission to do this. The curriculums that I write, the teachings that I may present to the community, I go to our people for validation. I don't go to them. I couldn't care less what they think of me. Why would I think the oppressor is going to approve my not being oppressed anymore? I'd have to be out of my mind. People say to me, brother, you are out of your cotton picking mind. And I tell them, yeah, I am out of my cotton picking mind. The problem is you're in a cotton picking mind. Brother, if this is to be, every morning that I get up, I look in the mirror, I throw a kiss at myself, and I say, if it is to be, it's up to me. Collectively, what we're doing here, if it is to be, it's up to we. We must do this. We must educate our children. We must write our curriculum. We must write our story without any concern of what they think.
Yes.
That's what I've done all my life, brother.
Ashe.
Ashe.
All right. We have a question that says, is there any spiritual practices, rituals that I can do to preserve? It's talking about Mott. So let me start at the beginning. He said, I brought an hieroglyphic drawing of the Mott concept from my travels to Egypt last week. And my question is there any spiritual practices, rituals that I can do in order to preserve its essence within? Or can I solemnly believe that the concept is already embedded in my DNA?
You were born with it. And the first step in everything that we do that takes us to where we got to go, love yourself. Self-love is the first step that moves everything forward. When you look in the mirror, some people say, I hate how I look. You should never tell yourself that. You should say, I love how I look, but there are things I can do that can improve my position. But you got to love yourself. The only way you could be successful in becoming who you want to be is to love yourself, not hate yourself. You can't operate from a negative perspective and then progress. You have to operate from a positive perspective. Love yourself. Love the shape of your nose, the thickness of your lip, the complexion of your skin, the kink in your hair. Love it. Love it. And understand that the Creator don't make mistakes. We are living in a world that's trying to make money. They're trying to make you, if you're heavy, they're trying to make you thin. If you're thin, they try to make you heavy. If you're light, they try to make you dark. If you're dark, they try to make you light. Yeah. Okay? If your hair is kinky, they try to make it straight. And if your hair is straight, they give you something called frizzies so that it can look a little frizzy. People are making money on making you try to be somebody that you were not born to be. I'm sorry, I got other things to do with my money. And that ties into the question about finances, priorities. Ain't nothing wrong with having good things, but prioritize what you spend your money on.
All right. So we only have 3 minutes. Brother Kaba, can you go another 15 minutes?
Sure.
Okay, we're gonna end at 6:45 this evening, and we have a question. Well, Barbara would like for you to speak on the anniversary of Malcolm X assassination, but before you get to that, Sister Judy has her hand raised, and I'm gonna let her ask her question. Go ahead, Judy.
Greetings, Kaba. How are you?
Peace, my sister. I'm doing excellent. How are you?
I'm doing well. I'm one of your cousins from Tuskegee.
All right. Are you in Tuskegee by chance?
No, I'm in Atlanta, but I am a
Well, I'll be
native.
coming to Atlanta in April. I'm gonna take a trip over to Tuskegee.
Oh, wow. I would love to take you on a tour, but I know you're familiar. What are you gonna do at Tuskegee, if I may ask?
Oh, come on. Ask
I'm going
a question.
home.
Judy,
I'm
going
you
home. That's where my daddy's from.
Tuskegee, and I would like to ask him if he's coming there for something professional to speak to students. That's my question. Thank you.
Am I going to Tuskegee to speak to students?
Yes.
No, I'm going to Tuskegee because I'll be in Atlanta, and I heard that Tuskegee is only 2 hours away. And, you know, growing up, I always went to my mother's land, which was Boston, Massachusetts. I never got a chance to go down south. My name is Booker T. Coleman Jr. My father was senior from Tuskegee and Marion. And it's interesting you asked this question. I read a book by Charles Blow that's titled The Devil You Know. And he says to get the kind of black power that we're looking for, he's saying we need to return south. You see, between 1910 and 1971, there was a movement of Africans from the south to the north thinking that they would get some kind of freedom and abilities. So they moved north. And my father came up prior to World War II. He came up from Tuskegee. And Charles Blow says that, you know, we can do all the marching we want. Dr. Clark said the only thing marching does is wears the soles of your shoe out, thing like that. But to get real power, if we were to return back to our ancestral home down south, so many of us are from the south. And if we should set up, we would get the black power that we're looking for through voting. We wouldn't have to beg people for reparations. We'd give each other reparations, because we'd run the politics up. And so what I'm thinking about is, I'm thinking about relocating to Alabama. Because I think that if we really want power, we can spend our lives arguing with the police about killing us and shooting us, or to people who are shooting and killing us. But if we were to return back in a solid base, that would be black power. As we entered into the political system, I would, whatever I could do educationally, I would do. So the reason why I'm going to Tuskegee is because I want to reconnoiter the area. And I want to see if within the next year or two, if I could touch base with family members, or if I could touch base with the community that would say, you know something, we really would like you down here. We'd like you to educate. We'd like you to come down and do some work with us in education. If that could happen, I would do it.
I'm going to make that happen.
Say again, my sister.
I plan to make that happen. I know some people who are supporters of you that live in Tuskegee.
Oh, wow.
City
okay.
Councilwoman and the mayor. But I don't want to irritate any particular person, but I wanted to, the question that I had was about the darkness and the sun. You mentioned that the stars were kind of a crystallized. I'm not exactly sure how you stated it. I'm sorry, I'm getting over a cold. But you mentioned that the stars are crystallized, they're really black. And I noticed that I was studying something recently and someone else was talking about the sun. And when you look at the sun, if you're stargazing, and I've done that, and I see it, you start to see that the sun is really black.
When you get out of our atmosphere, the sun is black.
Right. So I wanted to see if you would just share a little bit about that.
Yes. And let me tell you something else. They just found through their astronomy and things like that, they just found out that that they have just found a constellation. Well, I should say a star system that there is a quasar. A quasar is like, what happens in the center of every galaxy, there's a black hole. And the thing about a black hole is that a black hole is so strong, it attracts and captures everything It eats up stars. It eats up everything, and it makes everything collapse inside of the blackness. But in that happening, it creates a halo of light around it.
Wow.
Everything, you know, in the 60s, we used to say black is beautiful. But quite frankly, black is the only thing that exists. Everything comes out of blackness. And the way in which I taught my children, kindergarten children, because my background, my early career was with kindergarten children, we get white paper, construction paper, and we would get the 8 colors, the primary and the secondary. And we'd start with a line that goes across red. We would just write a line, do a line in red. And then we get to the next secondary color. When you mix red and yellow, you get orange. We get orange and we draw a line over the red. Then we get the yellow and draw a line, okay? The secondary color between yellow and blue is green. So we'd get the green crayon and draw a cross. And then we get the blue and draw a cross. Indigo is the only color in the ultraviolet infrared spectrum that indigo has two. There's two levels of indigo. We'd get an indigo crayon, draw a line over that. Another indigo, draw a line over that. And then we'd finish with the final color, which is purple. Those are the 8 primary and secondary colors. With kindergarten children, I would ask them, okay, now what color is that line? It's black. The collection of all colors is black. The absence of colors is white. Not superior or inferior. Science. And the evidence is right there. So my next statement would be to them, don't you see how beautiful you are? That's why black is beautiful, because it's the only thing that exists. Everything else comes out of the black.
Beautiful.
And so when you're dealing with the idea of crystallized blackness, look at a diamond. A diamond is when you take coal and you press it in under the earth. You press it in and you press it in and you press it in, so there's no more room. When there's no more room, that blackness becomes a diamond. Science. It's not personal. It's just the way it is. Plants were born to be green. Humans were born to be black. Science.
All right, brethren. Just a couple of more questions. I want to thank everybody for hanging and staying. We've had a beautiful audience and audience participation. We've had Brother Kaba, Professor Cabanet. We have people from Virginia. We have people from Atlanta. We have people from Texas. We have people from the Bay Area, San Francisco Bay Area. We have people from all around the country. So people way up in Chico, California. We have all of these people, and we're glad that they're. Roberta, is Bobby here by any chance? Did Bobby come? No.
I had lunch with Bobby this afternoon.
Oh, you did?
I did. She's on her way back to Las Vegas.
All right. Yeah. Well, we'll take that offline, but I was hoping that she was here. Sister Barbara wants you to talk about the anniversary of Malcolm, his assassination.
Okay. Please, may I say something to my sister from Tuskegee? I'll be in Atlanta from April 7th until the 14th, and I'll be speaking at JB's Record Lounge. Mm-hmm. I believe it's Saturday the 13th. I'll be there.
Okay.
So just for your information, that's when I'll be from 7 to the 14th.
Okay. I'll make a connection with you.
I'm sorry?
I will make some connection with you. I'll talk to Minister Imhotep and get your information.
Beautiful. Thank you, my sister. I appreciate that.
And I'm Judy Gresham.
Judy Gresham? Okay. You know, when in my documentary, What Would Malcolm Do?, I begin the documentary by talking about my first and only experience with Malcolm X as a 7-year-old boy in Harlem. And long story short, because I don't want to give away too much in case some of you might want to see the documentary. The thing I took away from that was I was probably the youngest person there. I worked my way through the crowd and I was standing right up in front of him. I'm 7 years old and I'm standing right up in front of him because I saw the crowd. I was interested. My mother was getting her hair done at Larissa's. And so I decided I wanted to come down and check out what was going on. And I remember I saw this tall man, real tall. I mean, for me, where I was at seven, he was tall. He was a giant. And I was just looking up at him. But there was something I was thinking. I was trying to figure out where his forehead ended and his hairline began. I had never seen a man whose complexion and hair was the same color. And I'm looking up and I'm trying to see where his hairline began. And I'm just staring up at him. Long story short, everybody disperses. This gentleman goes his way, the crowd goes their way, and I go back into the beauty parlor. A brother that worked in the beauty parlor, you know, a lot of times sisters that own shops, they would have a brother do all the work, things like that, change the light, do whatever was, and also security. This brother come rushing in to the beauty parlor. And see, my mother's beautician, Mrs. Jefferson, she had the first stall, and there was like a seat with plants, not a seat, but like a place where you could sit. And that's where I used to always sit and look out on the streets of Harlem between 120th and 121st and 7th Avenue. And so I was sitting there and this brother comes rushing in. And he says to everybody that's in the beauty parlor, you wouldn't believe who was just here talking to us. They said, Miss Jefferson said, well, who was it? You're not going to believe. She said, well, who was it? And I'm looking at him. He said, that's Malcolm X was talking to us. And they said, oh, hey, Malcolm wasn't talking to you. He said, yeah, he was. Ask that young brother right there. I bet you he'd tell you everything Malcolm said because he was looking dead up in Malcolm's eyes. Family, I couldn't tell you anything that Malcolm said because I was trying to figure out where his forehead ended and his hairline began. And I always tell this story as it relates to when you're around children.
Yes.
You yeah. never know what they're thinking. They're looking at you. You may think they're intensely listening to what you say. But they may be thinking something totally different. And I've always carried that experience with Elhaj Malik El Shabazz as a child with me everywhere I go when I'm around children, because I'm always careful what I say and what I do. And is what I say what I'm doing?
Ooh.
Because they'll pick it up.
Yes. Yes.
And I always tell that story with my experience because it's more than just my experience with him. I'll be honest with you. I wish I could lie and tell you that he put his arm around me and said, hey, young brother, how's it going? And, you know, it didn't happen. But the story that I tell with my experience with him has even more value because of what I remember. Now, I'm going to take you to when I was in the sixth grade. And I was watching the news. Now, this is when I'll tell you, I was about to become 12. I was doing a project, a social studies project. And I remember the news was on. And they came across and said that the preacher of hate had been killed. And right there, I knew they weren't telling the truth. Because when I was in the middle of that group, remember, I'm a child. I'm picking up the energy of the group. I'm picking up the energy of the person that's talking. I may not be listening to what they're saying. I may not hear. But what I do hear them say is, preach, brother. Preach, brother. We love you, brother. And he's coming back, and I could feel, see, because I'm in the middle. The crowd is around me. I'm in the middle, and there's Malcolm X in front of me. I'm feeling the love that's coming from the group to Malcolm and the love that Malcolm is sending to the group. That's how I knew they weren't telling the truth. Because I could feel the love between our people and Malcolm, and Malcolm and the people. And that's my own personal experience. I still, as I'm telling you this story, I can still feel what I felt then as a child. And that's why we have to be so careful with our children, because our children carry legacies with them. And just like I'm giving you a love ethic, if it's not a love ethic, if it's not a good situation, they carry that trauma with them too, which goes back to Nisi Mariana.
Yes.
Okay. It goes back to our people. Our people are hurt by matter of degree. They're hurt very badly. And I would never want to do anything that would have them hurt again. And when I hear our people and I see what they're going through, I do my best to try to navigate the emotions of what I'm experiencing, because I know that they hurt. They have hurt that we don't know, because everybody goes through hurt differently. Some of it is not just child hurt. It's intergenerational. It's transgenerational. It's something we pass from generation to generation, from when we were first stolen in Africa and put on the ships and then bought and sold and then on the plantations, what we went through on the plantations. There was a song that was sung by Paul Robeson. And I think about it. The song is, "Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child." And that's who we were as a people. We were a motherless child. Not just mother as the terms of who birthed us, but mother as the terms in terms of the country we came from.
Yes.
We were a motherless child. We came from a society that nurtured us and sustained us and loved us and built us. I'm not saying, you know, we had our situations, there's no doubt. But for the most part, we were conditioned by this experience, and we were pulled from that and put in a very hostile situation. And through generations, we passed that pain down from generation to generation. And now here we sit in 2024 in a collective unconscious of all of our experiences. And it takes people like yourself, who's working with our people, to bring them through a process to understand. This is why I always say, it's going to get better. And ain't going to be no such thing as the good old days. Because in America, Black folk ain't never had good old. Black folk ain't had good days. The only way you could have good old days is if you ever had good days. Our good days are yet to come. And our good old days are even further in the future. But they're coming. Our ancestors did not do what they did to leave us like this.
All right. All right. I'm going to let that be the last word. I want to say this Sunday, Wolfsay Community in Sacramento will be meeting in person. I dropped the flyer in the chat for you to get that. Brother Kaba, life, prosperity, and health to you itinually. And let's close with Bob this evening, sisters and brothers. Let's close with Bob.
Ashe.
Ashe.
Great power.
ourselves from mental slavery. No matter ourselves can free our mind. I've no fear for atomic energy, cause none of them can stop the time. Our love shall kill our prophets while we stand aside. Look, some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. Won't you ask the same? These songs of freedom is all I ever am. Redemption song. Redemption song. Redemption song. From mental slavery, number two ourselves can free our mind. Whoa, I've no fear for atomic energy, cause none of them can stop off the time. Our love shall kill our prophets while we stand aside and look. Some say it's just a part of it. We got to fulfill the book.
Rastafari. All right. Give thanks and praise to the Most High. Glad everyone could join us. We hope to see you next time, next Wednesday. Yes, life, prosperity, and health must make the sign of the Ka. Thank you, Brother Kaba.
Thank you, Brother Kaba.
Thank you, Brother Kaba.
Thank you,
Brother
Kaba.
Beautiful.
Awesome.
Thank you for the opportunity. I look forward to the future. All power to the people.
Right. Soon come, brethren. Soon come. All right. Give thanks to everyone. Sugar D. We have people in there in Virginia and Florida.
Thank you.
And
grateful.
All the people that came in today. Thank you, Sebastian.
I just don't want to leave this energy just sitting in it. Just sitting in it. Ooh, it's good.
Yeah. Hey, Keisha. Keisha is there too. All right. Give thanks.
Keisha.
Yeah, she don't have her name, but she's there. She's there. Thank you, Dondi Way, for coming. Minister Alicia, Mama Rose, Sister Zarita will be giving the message on Sunday. We're looking forward to that. So, guidance and protection, everyone. We're signing off.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Blessings.